So I'll just freelance for a second while we're getting the technical stuff set up. I'm very happy of how this worked. We had a structure in mind when we put people together, and especially what we ended on, and this whole hypothesis that play, and I would use the term play in English. In English, actually, spiel gets separated into play and game. Let me get my notes here. And I would use the term play to talk about what Dirk Becker proposes at the end, proposed during his talk, because what he's describing is actually one of the highest forms of play. It's a kind of play that reflects on the rules of play and actually is able to transform the rules of play. And I think, it would be a great thing if that is truly the cultural form of the coming society. My next speaker, who is setting up as as I talk, is actually someone who is operating in this field. His name is Paolo Pedicini, and he is a game designer, game developer, artist, and educator. He teaches digital media production and experimental game design at the School of Art at Carnegie Mellon University. Since 2003, he has been working under the project name Mala Industria, which is Italian, that's where Paolo's coming from, for soft industry or soft factory. And he produces, as he puts it himself, homeopathic remedies to the idiocy of mainstream entertainment in the form of free, short-form online games. And you might not have, heard of him. You might have heard of Mala Industria, but I'm pretty sure a lot of you have heard of these games because they've gotten quite a lot of media resonance. We're talking about games like the iPhone Story, a little iPhone game that you can download and lets you sort of play through the production of how these, so-called smartphones that we all use are made, and it's a critical reflection of that process. Or the McDonald's game, which lets you, partake in the simulation of running McDonald's, and you get to see the different production processes that go into that, and is a critical reflection on that. Apollo is actually one of the main examples that Ian Bogost talks about in his book on procedural rhetoric. We were talking about, rhetoric going back to Aristotle. Nowadays, with interactive media, we have new forms of rhetoric, and Apollo is on the forefront of seeing what one can do in games. And I think he's going to be talking about that in his talk. I think everything's set up. It's on the wall, so I'll finish my introduction. Mala Industria's products range from satirical business simulations, McDonald's game is one, oil oligarchy is another, to meditations on labor and alienation, from playable theories to politically incorrect pseudo-games. All of this stuff is online and it's for free, so I can highly recommend checking out the site. We do have one of his games in the exhibition because I do think it's worthy of being shown in a context like this. We have Unmanned, which lets you slip into the role of a drone pilot sitting out in his container in Nevada, steering an unmanned drone in the Middle East, with the capability of shooting off Hellfire rockets, and it lets you partake in his everyday life. And I'm very, very happy to have you here, Paolo, and I think you're set up, so I'm just going to let you do your presentation, and I'm very intrigued to hear what you have to say.
All right, thank you very much, yes. All right, thank you for the introduction. Is this going? Yeah. That was sort of the title, Critical Plaything, Designing for Second-Level Players. I'm going to explain what I mean by second-level players, but actually the original talk was about the interactive Goebbels, because the starting point is this quote here by game designer Chris Crawford. He's a veteran of the game industry. He says, at that point, Chris Crawford was designing political simulations, economic management games, and he realized by making these things how his position of designer allowed him to create very misleading representations of real-world systems, because he had to create, a simulation of a Cold War or something, and he had to create the internal relationship, kind of like code them, and decide what variables were relevant, what were not relevant, and so on. And this is sort of made worse by the fact that games, digital games, are more opaque than other media, linear media, or even like board games, for example, in which you have all the rules in front of you and you know exactly what creates what and what is random and what is not. So like the inner workings are still like quite less exposed, and the designer biases are harder to discern. So consider that in the 90s, well, games were still the most popular instances of digital computational culture. Now we have much more. But the statement, I think, can be applied to any computational algorithmic artifacts, really. Most of us are still too dumb to figure out how the inner workings of simulations and digital social networks, digital media, work, also because they are so opaque, they are rarely open source, right? So yeah, today in the era of ubiquitous apps, I think an evil genius of propaganda will be a different kind of animal, will be something different. Like as Deleuze said, we moved from disciplinary societies to societies of control, right? Or to control societies. Like power doesn't operate primarily by discipline and punishment, by kind of imposing homologation. That was kind of the narrative of the first personal computer TV ad, the kind of sort of like 1984 situation in which everybody's gray, and then finally the personal computer shows up, which is Apple, and kind of breaks the big screen, the big TV, and big media. But yeah, now power today works in a more subtle way by tracking and persuading, by adapting and quietly steering people's behavior, right? Centralized and unidirectional mass media are not as important anymore. So the new Goebbels might be more like a constellation of practices and protocols that are implemented by, you know, well-intentioned engineers, well-intentioned designers, not necessarily aware of what they are doing. The new Goebbels are not seizing antennas or TVs or presses. They are reshaping the environment with, they're not gonna reshape the environment with architecture and things like that. But still, they will try to impose themselves as intermediaries for all human experience, for human experience in the same way. They will try to be the necessary interface between people and between people and information and between people and environment. And they will present it as a convenience, of course. The new Goebbels will have probably no plan and no specific party line and no mastermind, but we know that consistent and somewhat totalitarian imperatives emerge in all capitalist societies. You know, consume more, desire more, trust the ones who have power, so work for less, work for free, this kind of stuff. And I think the new Goebbels will not have to justify an ongoing genocide or hide an ongoing genocide. But if you think about climate change, you know, it's likely to cause mass extinctions and mass population displacements in the near future. So, and on the other hand, Malindustria is presented as a kind of like a remedy to the idiocy of mainstream games, as was said before. Like, in other words, in other words, it's using video games against themselves, essentially, subverting its language, subverting its trope, or like at least complicating its tropes, and foster a kind of a critical approach to this medium to play. This is an old example, Queer Power, and it's an example of this sort of process. This game sort of references the fighting game genre, like Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, and you can recognize the visual layout with two people sort of fighting and bars and stuff. But many elements are reversed. instead of having an energy bar, instead of taking away energy from your opponent, you're kind of giving pleasure. You have a pleasure bar. Instead of the special power, you have desires. And instead of hypersexualized characters, very ethnicized, stereotypical characters, you have shape-shifting aliens that can swap and switch their genders and their gender position as they like. So the result, instead of a fight, you have a kind of awkward, complex sexual intercourse between queer aliens. So the game doesn't really have a message. It's just envisioned as a parallel sex-centered universe opposing it to the sort of violence-centered universe that you usually see in games, especially this kind of fighting games. So I'm getting into the second level player. Starting from the 60s, this Italian semiologist, Umberto Eco, theorized that a text always constructs a double reader. Like the first level reader is the semantic reader and just wants to know what happens in the story. The second level reader is critical and it's more interested and enjoys the way the story is told. You see here, like a first player, the first reader is, just wants to know what's going on. The second level has a more like a critical distance and it might be a writer himself or herself. And these two types of reader coexist in the same person. It's not two categories of readers. You don't necessarily need to be a creator or a critic to be a second level reader. For example, like the way people discuss about TV shows today is often an example of like second level reading. When a spectator of serial TVs, they typically comment on the producer choices, they speculate on what characters might die next, and whether a producer choice was a good choice, and whether they are enjoying certain twists and turns. You know? And sometimes they even, like this kind of conversation outside on the internet and so on, even influences the producer choices. So it's not really a difference between highbrow and lowbrow culture. Like parables and fables for children with a moral kind of require a second type of reading, because you need to figure out what the author was trying to say in a moral, right? So Umberto Eco started to define his ideas in his open work back in the 60s. And at that point, self-referential and meta-referential works were kind of appearing in different media, in different fields, most notably John Cage, 4 minutes and 33 seconds. That's the silent piece of John Cage, right? Which is a very open work. That forces the listener to think about what is silence, what is music, what do we do when we listen to music. And a little bit earlier, Bertolt Brecht starts to develop his own type of anti-bourgeois theater. He saw the mainstream commercial theater as a branch of the narcotics business. That's what he thought. He thought it was based on emotional manipulation, and that was when the Nazis were using emotional manipulation to gain power in his country, which is this one. So, like, working class spectators were led to identify with powerful people and kings, and he wanted to work against that, and so he developed strategies to break the suspension of disbelief, and now we know, like, the breaking the fourth wall, alienation or estrangement effect, addressing the public, and going meta, and so on, and revealing theatrical technologies and techniques. He will show and have actors referencing theatrical devices, right? And I think this concept can be translated in games as well, and a lot of artifacts as well, though not really directly. I think games always require some kind of critical awareness. When you're playing chess, you don't really identify emotionally with a king or a pawn. You don't really feel bad for a piece that you know gets eaten, dies. You mostly look at the rules system and the ways to exploit the rules and maximize your gain and improve your position. Even players of immersive fantasy games like World of Warcraft aren't really spending that much time pretending to be in a magical land. They are most of the time are just executing tasks. They have a list of things to do. They are taking decisions that are purely functional. And if anything, I think it's precisely this required effort in calculation and instrumental thinking that can foster a critical play. The Euro-style board game Puerto Rico, for example, which is similar to a lot of games like Settlers and so on, for example, portrays the colonization of the island of Puerto Rico as a kind of like a resource management game without really referencing exploitation of African slaves or the genocide of indigenous people that actually happened in the reference period or shortly before or shortly after. So you're kind of like allocating these brown tokens that are your workers to plantations, and they are settlers, I think, and they are kind of abstract and they are kind of decontextualized from any history or origin. They're just resources to manage, and that happens a lot in board games, but also in digital games. This is a counterexample. It's an art board game called Train. It's by Brenda Brathwaite or Brenda Romero, and exploits this kind of functionalist thinking, this functionalist mindset, but also challenges it. Often it produces a strong emotional reaction in the player who get to play it. So Train employs what the author calls procedural gaps. There are parts of the game that are not explained, that are not really completely defined or formalized. So player in the game, essentially players compete to put this little pawns in the trains, and there is a management system there too, and until usually they draw a card that reveals the destination of these trains, and the card will say Auschwitz, right? And a player discovered that they've been essentially playing a game that is about the logistics of the Holocaust. And I think in a way it's almost the opposite of the Brechtian theater. Like, players are induced to follow an abstract, detached, compelling system of rules to execute tasks, and then there is some kind of emotional identification and empathy that is brought in a maybe a contrived way to break this illusion and almost to shame the homo economicus that is within us that is playing these games. And I think non-strategic games can also produce a kind of acritical engagement. There are a lot of games that are that require twitch gameplay, kind of like fast reaction, quick reactions. And this kind of quick reaction can also produce a fairly obvious detachment, because you're just like mechanically following what the game tries to make you do, and they employ very fast cycles of rewards and punishment, like famously Flappy Bird or similar skill games. So this is my version of Flappy Bird before this is phone story that was mentioned before, and this is a game I made with a few friends a couple of years ago. It's a smartphone game about the production process of smartphones themselves. So imagine it, seeing it in your actual handheld device. And it shows its hidden social costs and environmental costs. It depicts the various phases of the manufacturing process, starting from the coltan mine in Congo, going through the assembly lines in China, and all the way through the disposal in someplace in East Asia, where all the electronic waste is kind of badly recycled in very unsanitary conditions. And the story is told by very simple games that are kind of mechanical, and by the gadget itself, that face that you saw before that kind of addresses the player as consumer. You can hear the voiceover here.
Like most electronic gadgets, yes, this phone was assembled in China, inside a factory as big as a city.
So it's very straightforward, but it also puts you in the game immediately, so you kind of start playing without thinking too much, almost automatically. All the games are really simple, are kind of a bit mocking the type of games that are popular on handheld devices. They are very casual, very simple, so you kind of like start playing automatically, and then slowly the voice, the story, the narrative kind of draws the context around these vignettes. So the player is symbolically implicated in participating in this production process, but also it's not a completely symbolic relationship because he or she is holding the very product of this process.
Of course.
So I think we can try to activate a second level player to redirect the attention to important issues, but we can also kind of vaccinate the player against all types of manipulations that can happen in all types of games and all types of simulations. So like making subversive works can be, I think, an act of design-based criticism or object-based criticism. And it's about kind of building literacy, like empowering players and users. We can critique games by writing and talking about them, but we can also use the games themselves to talk about games and turning their language upside down, which is, by the way, what culture jammers have been doing since forever, like, I guess, starting from the Dada movement and all the way to the Billboard Liberation Front. This is a famous example. It's a group or a series of groups that will intervene on big billboards and kind of modify them, usually in minor modifications that are completely reversing their message and potentially shaming whoever put that first message in the first place. Subvertising, also called. Sometimes it involves, yeah, defacing actual ads, and sometimes it just operates on a language level. Like this is a mainstream contemporary example of how subvertising function. It's a humorous video.
When I'm watching a commercial for a tech device, I'm looking for an ad that's fun.
That's cool. That's edited way too fast. With a lot of lines repeated a bunch, just like that.
Like that.
And starring young professionals with creative jobs.
Jobs you're not even sure exist.
I'm a wicker weaver.
I'm looking for a commercial that uses words like now.
Emotion.
Global.
Tsunagatteiru.
Spoken totally out of context.
Or in unison while laughing.
Fast.
I want an ad with diversity. Because it doesn't matter if you're a guy
or a girl,
white or black.
I want to see lots of small business men and women, like architects,
gardeners,
bakers,
a whole lot of bakers,
or at least someone holding a baguette, like me.
I'm looking for a commercial set to an indie rock song, one that uses a lot of accordion,
or glockenspiel,
or this instrument.
Most of all, I'm just looking for a good product, shop.
No, one with kids. Cute kids, though.
Hey, guys, can you see me? Hi, I miss you.
And a soldier.
Hey, Baba.
You know, emotional shit.
His daddy.
That's what'll get me to buy a smartphone.
Or a wearable computer.
Or a website that finally puts me in the driver's seat.
Whatever that means.
One more baker.
And a logo without text.
Yeah, so you've seen things like this before. This is actually like a commercial sort of product. This is like humor you can find online, properly produced, but to me it shows how it's now, like the culture jamming and subvertising is quite pervasive in our culture. It's something that we are used to as like bullshitters, marketers, and bullshit detectors are in constant competition and coevolution. This is a McDonald's video game, a management game, a management simulation I made in 2005. You play as the CEO of the company, of the McDonald's company, managing the process of production of a hamburger. And it looks like it is presented as an official advertising game, but it's actually a critique of the fast food industry. Because when I made my simulation, I wanted to add what is usually called negative externalities. Those are the impacts of a production process that are considered not good. Like positive externalities will be like employment, and negative externalities will be like things like pollution or some kind of poisoning and so on. So yeah, unhealthy food, deforestation. So the player is soon realizes that in order to be profitable, to please the board of directors, he has to, or she has to, make some kind of unethical choices, like destroying a rainforest in order to make room for more pastures or more soy fields for cows fodder. And you know, like these are not things that you usually see in management simulations. You don't see that in the bucolic scenarios of Farmvilles. You don't see that that kind of things, because they are mostly idealized capitalistic fables, because they are, these aspects are depressing, they are controversial, although pretty much everything in the game is well documented. And these things are not part of the dominant hegemonic narrative of entrepreneurship, although they can be made into a game and they can be interesting elements of a fun game. This is another cow-related example that I cannot really play that well because I don't think it's online anymore. But this cow clicker was made by game maker and theorist Ian Bogost. And it's a procedural satire of these games like Farmville. You know, Farmville are based on sort of like delaying pleasure and forcing people to pay in order to not quite play the game. So the core game mechanic of cow clicker is as stupid as it sounds. It's you have to click this cow, and once you click a cow, you get some point, and then you have to wait for the next click. And in this case, it's 2 hours and 55 minutes. And in order to get another point, you just have to wait and log in later. And you know, it's embedded in Facebook, so it's meant for an always connected sort of audience and player base. But there's also a way out. You can pay 10 in-game credits to skip that wait time, right? And in order to get in-game credits, you usually have to pay real money. And it seems stupid, but that's essentially the distilled version of what a lot of social games, Zynga games that are not that popular anymore, thank God, but still, like, there are micropayments that are kind of based on that. Or I'll give you an sort of interesting game that is kind of broken, and if you want to fix it, you have to pay. So that's I think that's a great way to explain the inner workings by essentially stripping it down to its very structure. So this is another cow-related example. This is an example from, this is a scene from Kino Ai by the Soviet director Zygmunt Viertov. You might know him for the Man with the Movie Camera, which is a little bit more famous than this one. So this is a documentary about the daily life in a Soviet village. This is still the heroic period of the Soviet Revolution before, you know, purges and stuff. Or, well, at least it was still a relatively optimistic moment. And, you know, in the previous scene of this movie, a woman bought some meat from the private sector and not from the cooperative, and she realized that it was a mistake. And it's a propaganda movie, no mistake. And something weird happens. The movie starts playing backward, and you kind of go I think this might be already the backward situation. Oh, yeah, that's what happens. And so the movie has this moment of freak out that at that point was unthinkable, and just plays back and kind of recreates the production process of this cow, what happened to this cow before its meat was sold. And so you see the entrails being pulled back into the carcass. And that was like a special effect at that point, right? And the narrator, we dress the bull in his skin, it's not really a character, it's not really the voice of God, it's more like the spirit of cinema, almost like the Kino Ai is almost the camera, the spirit of cinema's language. And Viertov, way before Brecht, also didn't like the emotional dramatic cinema that was emerging at that point, was being established in mostly in the US and other parts of Europe. I think he probably got fired at some point for criticizing emotional movies, like Eisenstein was making a very emotional propaganda movie, and he was a bit more analytic. And in his other work, The Man with a Movie Camera, employs a whole repertoire of meta devices. It shows you how a movie is made. He shows you the camera that is filming the actual movie. It shows you even how the camera works at the very beginning, how the optics of the camera work. And all in a fairly compelling, although not completely narrative, storytelling sort of thing. So. And this happens to be a quite contemporary concern too. Where does our food comes from, right? There are a lot of artists and researchers that are sort of backtracking the production process of a certain commodity and like doing exactly what the movie does, unpacking the meat production process. But in his case, unpacking the meat production process overlaps with unpacking the production process of a film. So, well, French director Jean-Luc Godard was also a fan of Ziga Vertov, and he didn't really have issues with fiction itself or with emotion itself, but he also, despite that, he also devised a whole set of, a whole toolkit of techniques for estrangement. These are like, if you've seen Godard's movie, they are pretty narrative, usually love stories, but then they have like moments of freak out, like this one. Like a push you kind of out of the narration, uses lyrical text that kind of like puts characters out of context suddenly. Jump cuts, you know, characters looking at the camera and weird sounds coming up. And this was what came to be known as counter cinema, not because it was completely against cinema, because it was an alternative way to find cinema. Now a lot of these techniques are commonly used in mainstream movies, but counter cinema was a loose group of independent filmmakers who opposed the dominant ideology of essentially Hollywood type kind of movie, Hollywood cinema. And these are some of the lines of conflict between cinema and, I don't know if you can read it, between cinema and counter cinema, things like narrative transitivity versus narrative intransitivity, like instead of following, one thing follows another, gaps in interruption, and which is something that you now see in contemporary movies pretty well. It's not counter that much counter anymore. Identification versus estrangement, that sort of, instead of feeling what the character feels, Godard is like, oh, well, I'm gonna push you out of the, I'm gonna break your suspension of disbelief, even if for a little while. Transparency versus foregrounding, and so on. And in 2006, the critical theorist Alexander Galloway, Alex Galloway, claimed that an approach similar to counter cinema was appearing in games as well. And his main examples were the kind of stuff that game artists were doing at that point. It kind of looked like this. There were artistic modifications of commercial games that happened to be open source. And so artists will just break them and sabotage their code and turn them into beautiful artifacts, glitch aesthetics artifacts. Sometimes creating different kind of games or creating different kind of experiences. If you think, I sometimes compare it to like what Gordon Matta-Clark will do with architecture, kind of cutting through the architecture to reveal the structure and possibly even imagine different kind of architectures. And Galloway claimed that the artistic modifications, like this one by the Catalan artist Retro U, which is one of my favorite, were counter games because they broke, let me see if I can play it again. Because they broke with the immersive, realistic tendency of mainstream games. These artists were mostly concerned with the issue of space and immersion, and therefore they were intervening in the 3D simulation technologies that at that point were kind of like new and emerging. Yeah. But I think these features of counter cinema can be projected more extensively can be more like starting points for more than just modification, artistic modification. I think that you can use this technique, pleasure versus unpleasure, and people are using it to make proper games, not just the derivative hybrid or mutants. This is a thing that you can play in the other room. It's a man. It's a narrative game about a day in the life of a drone pilot. You know, one of these people who operates a manned area vehicles in Pakistan or other like Yemen, while living their suburban life in Las Vegas or upstate New York, and the main formal feature you see that it employs a split screen and a split gameplay most of the time. So that my mind was reflecting the disconnection, the cognitive dissonance that these people might have in fighting a war while being on the home front. This kind of like 21st century warfare. And the choices are usually kind of trivial on one side. On one side, you have to do ordinary actions like brushing your teeth. Well, not brushing your teeth, but shaving. And on the other one, on the other side, you usually have a more introspective or monologue or dialogue. So, and some tasks are quite tedious, actually, like this one. And there are constant references to other games sometimes, like there is a dating game, there is a sort of a driving game, and a game within a game toward the end. Let me skip forward. It's fairly linear, but whoop. Yeah. Then you commute in this fairly straight road in the middle of the desert, and then the main scene takes place in this kind of container, and it's what it's essentially a dating sim. You're sort of hitting with your colleagues while you're stalking this suspect, and you can ask her out or just get to know her. So yeah, the character itself is sort of divided. Like the main choices are, I guess, qualitative choices. You don't really have goals. You have some medals and some rewards. But the main mechanic is you get to decide what your character is and how this character will react or will respond to these events. Like he can be a depressed, self-loathing warrior, or it can be a jingoist. Jock dude, or anything in between. So, yeah, I think you can even imagine more like medium specific dichotomies that could awaken a second level kind of player. For example, preventing the player to become mere execution. Engines, you know, people seem to like, or at least that's what we are supposed to teach to our students, that people like clear goals, they like clear feedback. Are they doing fine? Are they not being good players? And so on. And that's a more kind of like a dominant design school of thought. But we can also challenge that. And still maintaining a gaminess or a game like this is a game I'm working on now. It will not really look like that. It will be more text actually. This is more like an arcade version. But yeah. Think about it. It's as a two-player game. It's not a split screen. You're seeing a compositing of two different screens that are visible to the two different players. And one player is the Israeli player, and the other one is the Palestinian. It's about that conflict, or lack of thereof. And you can see both perspective is asymmetrical, so both players have different kind of options. More importantly, each player sort of sees the world in a different way. Yeah, no, it's actually part of the video. All right. Yeah, it's just a quick screen capture. It will look quite different. But one thing that you can see is that both players essentially see themselves as surrounded by the enemy, right? So it's like a double, like an impossible space, and there will be events in the games that are being framed in a different way. And this is a local multiplayer game. It's meant to be played by people in the same room looking at two different screens. So the idea is that the players will work together to figure out what's going on, because it's not very straightforward. It's an abstract game. It references, you know, visual motifs from Arab culture, Arab art, and a more like militaristic logo version on that side. And the idea is to use a game as a conversation enabler to sort of encourage the player to negotiate out of the game and kind of share their experiences and maybe like maybe even fake their reactions and in order to get more land or get more power. So yeah, I think my time is more or less over. So I will have a bunch of other examples, but I would like to conclude here. So my view, the role of the critical game designer is the very opposite of the persuader. It's not always about telling things, but it's also about demystifying and disarm the rhetorical strategies of those who are in power. I guess that's the main difference between me and Ian Bogos. Like, he's like talking about these things and how to do it and kind of presenting almost like a manual to do this. I'm more interested in kind of packing the conceptual tools that are necessary to dismantle this procedural rhetoric along with these works. That's it. And yeah, you can play all the games online. Most of them are online. And follow me on Twitter. Okay,
37 minutes?
Yeah. That's okay. People have been going over a little bit, and we're taking the time for discussion. I actually just received news that we have one person who's fallen sick, so we will make up for lost time. And I want to take the necessary time to open up the discussion on this. Thank you very much for the very intriguing talk. I have to organize my notes in a second once other people start asking, but I'll just ask off the top of my head. the general theme you were. Quoting on, and you did ask me in the forefront, can we call this, you know, abort digital Goebbels or Goebbels 2.0? I said, no, we're in Germany. We can't be that light-footed, you know, with a name like this. Other people, okay, Wendy, I see you. But I think that what you're touching on with that, very provocative title, and I'm glad you showed it because I understood why you did it, is that, these are very, very powerful tools that we're just beginning to learn how to use and how to read and how to reflect upon. You know, Jan Dissemeyer asked yesterday whether we need to, think about the interface in a much more serious, paradigmatic way for our current culture. And this applies for these games as well, because the games are very inseparable from the interface you used to play them. And I think, the interactive rhetoric that you're reflecting upon with your works, and that is at work at all these commercial games, and that sort of disappears in the background, becomes invisible, just like the production processes become invisible, is something that we really do need to foreground, because it's going to shape. It is already shaping the world we live in to a great degree, and people are getting more and more adept at using it. And you talked about advert games; it's a widespread phenomenon, and it's very commonplace. I'm trying to hit a question here, but it's very common, or the thought that you touched upon that in game studies, other people have touched upon, is that games are in their infancy, and commercial games are sort of, they've been around for 20, 30 years, but they're still, when you look at commercial games, they're going for photorealism in 3D worlds, They haven't even begun to scratch the surface, or people like you have. Thank you for that. What the other arts have developed, and the processes they've gone through, and I think there's a great potential for interactive rhetorics that we can't even imagine yet. And so I don't know what are the most, let's hit the question, what are the most interesting areas for you said how you would like to activate the second level player, but for you at the moment, you showed us the game you're working on, but yeah. what are the most intriguing fields of research, design research, that you're working on at the moment?
Yeah, well, I guess some of my recent things and things I'm working on are multiplayer games, which is something I haven't. I have been delayed like for a while. Most of my games are actually single player games, and I'm working on multiplayer. I think that's they have a smaller market even in an artistic sense, because you need to have more people around the computer. That's not usually how you distribute that, although they kind of work well in a more like gallery exhibition situation, because yeah, you usually have at least like two people hanging out there. So I think that's an area that needs more exploration. There are definitely a lot of multiplayer games, multiplayer games that that are fun, that are sport and competitive, sport-like and competitive-like, but not many that are actually interesting or interesting in a sense that are used to create an interesting conversation among the players or interesting relationship among players. Usually the relationship is, oh, I'm going to compete with you, you know, or I'm going to, or we are going to collaborate to perform a task. Like there is a good example downstairs, a five-player sort of rocket controller thing. But it's to me, it's more interesting when there is more like a differential or like a more like awkward or less pleasurable relationship, not just let's all work together or let's compete on the same level. But what happens when there is something else, like there is more like a differential and so on. So that's that's the thing I'm quite interested in. Like you're saying, you say something that I'm quite interested as well in the issue of abstraction. Like now there is a bit of a revival in immersive spaces, and most of these immersive spaces are still quite, they might be magical realists, but they are still quite realist. They're still, because that's what the virtual reality sort of assumes, that you are in a 3D space and you are head is kind of like bobbling around in this 3D space. And it should be somewhat Cartesian, right? Somewhat Newtonian experience. And I think that's a bit of a limit. I think we are starting to see a bit more abstraction, even in 3D. Mm-hmm. And by abstraction, I mean things that are moving toward abstraction more than complete abstraction. And I think it might be in part due to the kind of technologies of 3D tracking and 3D capturing that we have now. Now we can use them in real time. Before that, we were just used in rendered CGI graphics. Now we can use that for video games as well. So you have like games that are employing real actors, and they have like finally they don't look like puppets, but they look like actual people, and they're a bit uncanny. But also, they are not usually used to in combination with anything interesting. So it's still like your stupid like game based on Hollywood tropes, except you have like better movements. And I think that we might be hitting almost like a photography moments. You know, like one of the main causes. Well, it's not one of the main causes, but one of the main factor for like artists like. Visual artists and painters to move toward abstraction was the fact that, well, now we have machines that are pretty good at capturing reality as it is. So, like, what is your role? It's almost like an existential crisis for image makers, right? And I think that might happen, like, as we automatize the process of 3D creation, and I can easily picture games made with, like, 3D scanning. So instead of modeling a whole room, you kind of, like, run a laser scan, and you can recreate it almost perfectly. So in that case, I think this paradigm might get more boring or more uninteresting, and just reliving the world as it is with slight changes might push us to explore different venues.
All right. I see, Wendy, you wanted to ask a question. I was paying attention, so I didn't look around the room, but now's the chance to give me a note. But that's actually, what I thought was also quite powerful in your talk is how you linked developments in the game culture with older media like film and photography to sort of just not make that break that's usually there between games and all the other arts, but actually to put it in line with artistic development.
Yeah. I shouldn't have opened that up
sorry, because it is Wendy's turn.
I think games have a kind of like a time advantage because they were like nobody really questions that a game is some kind of cultural artifacts. It might be shitty culture, right? It might be like a very lowest pop culture, but still, it's you know, has images, has a representational aspect, and sort of like, yeah, of course it's culture. People don't really realize that a lot of other things, the design things, are can be seen as culture as well, or equally culturally biased. And I think like a good example is Newsweek. Like, is a router a cultural element that takes some arbitrary choices, you know, design choices? Well, it could be. And what if?
So first of all, thanks for a great talk. And I love your work, and I teach it all the time. And I have a question, though, about the limits of dismantling. Because what's interesting about the McDonald's game, of course, is that there's the bizarre effect of sympathy for the CEO, right? They start playing the game and they really want to screw everyone over, and the CEO job is really stressful. So there was a bizarre sympathetic relationship. As well with Ian's cow clicker, right? That was his idea of dismantling the social media game, and it overtook his life. He spent his whole life, and it was the most successful game he ever produced. And so I wonder, to what extent this dismantling works. And then I'm also thinking about this in terms of what could call the Colbert effect, right? Where half the people think he's serious, half the people think he's mocking, but it's arguably that ambiguity that works. So to think through some of those ambiguities.
Yeah, that's an issue that I encounter all the time. And in part is unavoidable. I think the cow clicker example, I think, is a mythopoetic example and intentional mythology creation from the side of the author. There weren't that many players, and I'm pretty sure it didn't take over Ian Bogost's life. So it was like weirdly successful in its stupidity. So like, it was remarkable that some people actually found enjoyment in that parody game, but still, like, he made a point also by talking about it and by framing it in that way. Anyway, I shouldn't say that, but yeah, regarding like people who play maybe like McDonald's video games, this kind of like sarcastic, dark humor things, and then they sort of sympathize with CEOs and stuff. Yeah, that can happen. It's documented. There is anecdotal evidence that people might read it that way. I think it's part of it. I think the empathy aspect was never really a main point. So to me, it's not about showing like, hey, look at that, the CEO is immoral or unethical. To me, it's showing that the system of the game doesn't really punishes you for doing bad things in the same way that the free market system doesn't really have this feedback, doesn't really punish you as well. So there is something broken in the game, not in your behavior. So I also wanted to kind of move away from the greed argument that a lot of liberals like, right? Oh yeah, Wall Street people are greedy or like psychotic. Yes, they are. Of course, there is a self-selection process there, but it's also like what the framework that we create for them is just allows them to be so. So that's the problem, not the personal choice.
I actually would like to chime in on that question and ask you about in your experience designing games for over 10 years now, if I count correctly, what the edges of the subversion are. Like, when do you hit the boundary where you find, is there some kind of game grammatic or vocabulary that you haven't been able to subvert, or have you gotten feedback from players where the subversion didn't work in the way you wanted it to work? Like the example of McDonald's is a good example.
I don't know. I think it's better. I don't know. I find it better to work when there are issues that are not. At least that's what I thought. Whenever you have some kind of tension and some kind of interesting, debatable situation, you can create successful games, or at least games that are playable in situations in which you have a really strong power differential and a strong asymmetry. I guess that's very hard. Like, I've been trying to make a game about Israel and Palestine for a long time. There are some people who made some good ones, but it's hard because you have one side, one actor that is really disempowered and the other actor is really empowered. So either you pretend that one side is not completely and hopelessly oppressed and give this player agency, or you make something that, like, you make some kind of broken game that is making the point in that sort of very straightforward way. And that's why I always struggled in order to, like, yeah, I think in order to make the game more interesting in that case, I had to sort of step back almost to the origin, or like to the beginning of the state of Israel when, you know, Israel was attacked. And so, like, there was definitely Palestine and other allies in the Middle East had a chance to win, or like I had a chance to damage the other side. So that was my move, but I had to switch to very abstract things, because otherwise we'll have become like a huge historical epic game.
Please. Just one comment. I can imagine that's very difficult to model a game on that, that actually lets players choose to play both sides. Usually it's one-sided. When you know, you think about America's Army propaganda game made by the U.S. Army, you're only allowed to play the U.S. military. And then the Palestine ripoff of that game that was made, you're only allowed to play the rebel, you know. And so to have a game that includes both sides is really
that's
difficult.
That's interesting, because that also does that intentional, I guess, reframing. Like, I don't think we have a word for that, but reframing of the player point of view, because America's Army, you play with other people most of the time, and each of the two sides sees each other as terrorists. So you are always like the good guys, but then, you know, like there are other humans that see themselves as good guys, which is probably the most elegant statement about the war on terror made, you know, unconsciously by the military itself.
Okay, thank you.
Ich mache es in Deutsch und du wirst es ihm bitte übersetzen. Ich möchte gerne etwas über die ökonomischen Hintergründe wissen. Er hat davon gesprochen, dass Strategien aus dem Counter-Cinema in diesen Spielen aufgenommen werden. Nun wissen wir, Counter-Cinema war dann immer möglich, wenn es eine politische Initiative oder sagen wir eine politische Bewegung gab, die dieses Kino gedeckt und finanziert hat. Und mich würde jetzt interessieren, ob diese Art von Spielen einen ähnlich minimalen Platz einnehmen wie das Counter-Cinema heute oder wie auch, selbst wenn er international ist, der Autorenfilm heute gegenüber einer unglaublich massiven Präsenz von völlig anderen Filmen. Ist das, also Hollywood-Filmen natürlich, oder Filmen, die im Stil von gemacht werden, ist das im Spielebereich ähnlich?
She's asking about the economic background of, you know, what you're trying to do, and she took the example of counter cinema and said that only became possible when there were, you know, political, you know, support and funding of that kind of cinema, or when we're thinking about auteur cinema, you know. And so is there some kind of minimal backing for what you or what other people are trying to do here, you know, when you're trying to compete with, you know, this commercial game culture?
Yeah. I guess, yeah, definitely yes. And there is a movement that, although might not be as politically motivated, it is definitely mirroring that in terms of production. Like, there are a lot of small game developers called independent game developers that are starting to get more and more popular and more influential, actually. And then sometimes they are bedroom programmer that will just make little games in their basement or with like modest means, and the way they usually manage to compete with the giant multi-billion dollars by creating original products or products that are more like French cinema, products that are more personal, more like art house, because they are not like the direction and the authorship doesn't get watered down in a huge team of like 100 people with working in different areas in the world with like producers exerting pressure on what the product should be in order to be marketable. So we have definitely a situation that is quite mirroring that period. I don't think like public funding can play a role, or like institutional support can play a role, especially in Europe. Tales of Tales definitely tap into that, but they also run their own like Kickstarters. They also do like, they are a sustainable art house studio, and they do things that are not quite commercial, but still can sell. And weirdly enough, as opposed to independent musicians that have been getting economically screwed for like the last 15 years since the invention of Napster or other peer-to-peer sharing things, they had to sort of offset with touring and doing things like that. For a series of different factors, it's quite viable to sell your games in digital forms and make a living. You know, even if they are small games, I just don't have to because I have an actual job, like a job in academia. So I enjoy to not have to, you know, market this stuff as hardly as my colleagues in the commercial independent world do. But still, I think the.
I also think things like you mentioned crowdfunding and also online distribution platforms opened up new possibilities and
availability of tools, availability like certain cameras that were finally available to, you know, everybody. So there are definitely a lot of parallels.
And at the same time, I think it also reflects in the production aesthetics. I mean, it's you know, no secret why, you know, you, and these are Flash-based games, as far as I can tell, in many cases, and it's a completely different production aesthetics than when you're looking at AAA production titles that can cost up to $50 million, you know, dollars to make. You know, that's not what we're working with here. But that said, I did want to ask you while you were talking. I said, would you be interested in producing a AAA title if someone said, Paolo, we love your work, we give you free artistic reign? Would that even be interesting for you? Could you imagine, you know, employing these mechanisms that you presented to us today in a title that looks like anything else you could buy in the commercial market?
Yeah, it depends on the strings that will be attached. My favorite question is like, what if you had $1 million? What kind of game you would make? I will not make a game. I will do something else. I will like start my political think tank or something like that. You know? Like, my terrorist cell or something like that, like an eco-terrorist cell. No, I don't know. It really depends on the kind of freedom you will have, and I think in most of these cases, I like to release things quickly because they are sometimes time sensitive, or I want them to be participating in a certain conversation. I've been thinking like the Amend game could be like, you know, made more like a high profile with better graphics and more like longer and so on, and become like a commercially viable product. But still, I kind of wanted it to be out at that point in time when the discourse around this drone warfare was still happening. So to be a voice in that conversation, right? And at that point when it came out, there were no only like the Spiegel was talking about it, like the Guardian and a couple of newspaper. Like now we definitely have a lot of artists working on it, and we have something that at that point I didn't have access to, which is drone pilots kind of being interviewed publicly and going on newspapers. Like it was like one artist that managed to find one drone pilot that all like pixelated and blanked had some insights on their life. But at that point, I didn't have the source. But still, like that's part of what the game is. Like what are these people? What are they thinking? And what would you do in their place? And what are we doing in their place? Or, you know.
Well, thank you very much, Paolo. We've hit the time barrier here, and before we go on, I have to ask you, Jan, when we're going to continue this segment. But first, I'd like to thank you very much for your presentation and for the conversation. Thank everyone here.